to the world. Good morning.
The Lord is up.
Very good. Yeah, time to wake up and go to church. Okay, please welcome Caroline Barnett as our guest preacher today while Pastor Krista is on vacation this week. And please look on the back page of your bulletin for any announcements. Are there any other announcements that aren't in the bulletin?
Next week we're doing a study on Mark, the last 6 weeks. We'll read through the entire text. We'll look at some art. It'll be a fun 6 weeks, so please come.
9 o'clock.
Okay, then let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Please rise in body or in spirit and join with me in the call to worship. Jesus is here. How shall we welcome him? Like Simeon, let us sing our adoration and thanksgiving. Jesus is here. How shall we welcome him? Like Mary and Joseph, let us bow to him in wonder. Jesus is here. How shall we welcome him? Like Anna, let us praise him and share the good news of his coming. Jesus is here. How shall we welcome him? Like Mary, let us treasure these things in our hearts as we worship the Lord of all. Please remain standing and let us sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing, number 119 in the hymnal.
Thank you.
You may be seated. With the shepherds, we have heard the angels sing and have responded with our own joyful songs. Let us not forget that this is but the beginning of the story. Will we remain faithful as the story continues and as God's fullness of love continues to be revealed to us? Let us confess, first silently and then together as the body of believers. Let us pray. And let us pray together. God of love, it is such a joyous time of year. Let us not lose that sense of joy as we hear the rest of the story. With the teachers in the temple, let us listen to Jesus. Let us wonder at his wisdom. Let us believe his teaching. Let us rejoice as we learn from him. Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. May the peace of Christ be with you. Let us pass the peace of Christ to each other. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we continue to hear how Jesus gets ready for his call, may we too continue to prepare for our call. Amen. Our lesson from the Old Testament today is from Isaiah chapter 61, verse 10, through chapter 62, verse 3. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what it is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest, until her vindication shines out like the dawn, and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication, and all the kings your glory. And you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. Holy wisdom, holy words. Thanks be to God.
Friends, thank you so much for the opportunity to be with you today. My name is Caroline Barnett. I am a pastor in the Presbytery. And I'm grateful to worship with you on our very last chance of 2023. So today, our scripture reading comes from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 2, verses 22 through 40. So let us listen now for God's word to us. When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they, that is Mary and Joseph, brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he saw the Lord's Messiah. And guided by the Spirit, Simon came into that temple, and when the parents brought the child Jesus to him, for what is customary under the law, Simon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and a glory for your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed. And a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. The Lord be with you, and also with you. There's a moment on Christmas Eve when time seems to stand still. And it's a really rare feeling for the month of December. The pace of the holidays, the busyness of the season, the need to tie up all of our end of year threads, all of it hurls us toward December 25th at a breakneck pace. And there's rarely a still moment. And I don't know about you, but for me, this year in particular, the news and the violence and the war and suffering felt across this world seems unrelenting. So when there is so much suffering, how should we, how can we carve out a moment for joy and for peace? It's really busy, but then on Christmas Eve, something happens. Amid the candlelight and the carols, time slows down just a little bit. And sometimes it's only for a moment, but all that hustle and bustle, it fades away, and we say, Christ is here. God is with us right now. And then time stands still, if only for a moment, but then it picks back up again. And we make our way back out into a world filled with celebrations and schedules and to-do lists and grief and pain. Only now we go grounded in the promise that God is with us. But for that one moment on Christmas Eve, everything stops, and we are invited to be fully present in time, to be fully present to Jesus and Mary and Joseph as their new family is born. It's a brief moment, because time has a way of hurtling forward without any regard for our desire to pause and rest and reflect. And I suspect the same is true for Mary and Joseph, as today, just 1 week after Christmas, as we end 1 year and start another, Jesus' story jumps forward by about a month. 1 month has passed since Jesus was born in that manger, since all of those holy things happened. And in the month in between, I imagine Mary and Joseph have spent all of their time and energy raising Jesus, keeping him fed, putting him down for naps, changing his diaper. It's been 1 month of learning what each cry means, figuring out if it's a burp or a sneeze based on the look on his face. For Mary and Joseph, their life, like the lives of many new parents, it revolves around their child and the daily rhythms of life with an infant. So they don't have much time for rest or for pausing. They don't have much time for reflecting back on that beautiful, holy night, and they don't have much energy to wonder how their child of strange and miraculous origin, how he will grow up in this world. That is until they take a trip to the temple. They pack up all of their things and they travel so that they can dedicate Jesus at the temple. This is a normal part of life. It's an expected tradition and milestone that they would undertake. It's one more moment to mark time and occasion in their life. And it's there they meet Simon. Now, Simon has been waiting for them. He's been waiting for the Messiah for a long time, and now finally he sees Mary and Joseph enter the temple holding their baby boy. And in that moment, Simon knows that God is with us. And it's as if he cannot contain himself. He shares with Mary and Joseph the prophecy and the destiny of Jesus. He tells them that their son will be a light for revelation for people. He will give good news to people who need hope. And Jesus will be a person of glory and honor for his people. He tells them that Jesus is destined to do a great many things for a great many people in this world, and it all sounds really wonderful. Perhaps in this moment, Mary and Joseph stand a little taller with pride. Yes, their child might have just spit up over himself, but he's also a wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father. He is the Prince of Peace. And what parent wouldn't be proud of a destiny like that? But Simon doesn't stop there, because the destiny of Jesus includes more than praise and victories. Because Christ will be opposed by some. He will be thrown out of towns by others. He will upset powerful people. And ultimately, Jesus will die painfully, cruelly, far too young on a cross. So Simon sees all of who Jesus will be, and he tells Mary and Joseph about the future their child will walk into. And Scripture says Mary and Joseph are amazed by these words, but I wonder if there's something else running through their mind. Because for the past month, Mary and Joseph's lives have centered on raising their young son, making sure he is loved and safe. After months of waiting for this holy and unexpected child, he's finally here, and they're just trying to do their best to keep him safe. So to hear that the son they hold in their arms will face all the cruelty and injustice of humanity, and they will not be able to shield him, they will not be able to protect him. I wonder if that amazement holds other emotions. Grief, desperation, maybe even rage. Because if Jesus' destiny is life and death in service to God and others, then is the destiny of his parents, the first witnesses of his life, is their destiny to watch their heart that lives outside themselves break apart? That's as much as Simon and also the prophet Anna tells Mary that she has a destiny too. She will watch Jesus' suffering and it will grieve her. It will pierce her soul and leave her wounded in ways invisible to the eye. Love is a double-edged sword, isn't it? Because it is love that calls Mary to say yes to the Holy Spirit, to give birth to a son despite the adversity and gossip she may face because of it. It is the love she feels for her child that is both of her and beyond her that compels her to say yes to God. And it's a love that bonds her to her child to feel all the joy he will bring to participate in the justice he will achieve. And it will grieve her when he is hurt and broken and worn down. It is a love that will compel Mary to stand at the foot of the cross and refuse to look away as her son takes his last breath. So because Mary loves her son, her destiny is connected to his. This is the heart of the incarnation, our belief that God is with us through the human and incarnate Christ. We believe that God took on flesh and blood and bone to be with us and for us. And it is out of God's love for the world, for humanity, that God's heart exists in human form, a heart that is capable of love and joy and peace. But it is a heart that can be broken, figuratively and literally. Like Mary, God's destiny is to love the world by intertwining God's heart with humanity's, even if it means risking brokenness. And if the love of God that God has for humanity leads God into the most vulnerable and dependent forms of humanness, a baby, then where does that leave us? What exactly is destiny for the rest of us? Well, it's not so different than the one placed upon Mary and, by extension, I believe, Joseph as well. It is to love like Jesus, knowing that it is a type of love that will break our hearts. Rather than closing ourselves off to the pain of the world, the pain of others, the promise of Christmas that God is with us, and the ways Mary and Joseph have chosen to love their child, even knowing the sort of life he is to live, all of this reminds us of how to embody the same openness and care for others, even if it pierces our own soul. 10 years ago, there was a woman named Nicole, and she learned that she had cancer at a very young age. And she learned it wasn't the type of cancer you come back from. And so she and her husband, Matthew, and their two children faced the unfaceable together. Well, it was them and their friend, Dane. Dane, who they had met in college, who had no familial or marital obligation to love them. He visited one day shortly after Nicole's diagnosis, and he simply never left. For over a year, until after Nicole died, he stayed to care for them both and to help them raise their two daughters. He moved in. He gave up his job and his apartment in another city. His other friends, they didn't understand, and his other relationships suffered. They couldn't understand his decision. But still, Dane moved in. And he saw everything. All the unpleasant bodily pain that accompanies illness, all the emotional trauma that grief creates, he was in the thick of it, witnessing the starkest, grimmest details of life and death. They are the details we tend to hide from one another when we want to appear strong. And they are the details that end up making us human. He saw all the things that pierced Nicole and Matthew and their children's souls, and it pierced his soul too. In reflecting on Nicole's death, her husband Matthew writes, "The only remarkable element was Dane. I had married into this situation, but how had he gotten here? Love is not a big enough word. He stood and faced the reality of death for my sake. He is my friend." Dane loved his friends until his own soul was pierced. And Mary loved Jesus until her soul was pierced. And God loves humanity, and God's soul is also pierced. It's not that love itself should hurt, but to love like Mary loves, like God loves, it is to risk something for the sake of connection and openness. It is to say, "I am here for you in everything." And it is a lesson Jesus teaches us time and time again, not just at Christmas. Draw closer to one another in love. Draw closer to those who you have been told are unlovable. Draw closer to the pain of the world, the heartbreak of it all, and it's there you will find God with us. It's there you can participate in the work of Christ on earth. So it's why we pause on Christmas. This is why, amidst all the ways time will move us forward, and there are so many important things that call to our attention, we pause and we celebrate that God is with us in a way that calls us to be with one another and with all the world around us. It's Christ's destiny, but it's also Mary and Joseph's. And maybe it's also for the rest of us. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. Friends, in our scripture for today, Mary and Joseph take Jesus to the temple to present him to God and dedicate him as a holy one. We too can dedicate ourselves to God in so many ways. Through worship and study, we dedicate our hearts and our minds to the pursuit of God. Through fellowship and care, we dedicate our time and support to one another in need. Through mission and service, we dedicate our resources and our skills to make this world better for those who suffer most. Just as Mary and Joseph gave of themselves to raise Christ, let us give what we can to service to God through this church in the world. So let us take up our offering now.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O holy God, we thank you for the many gifts and blessings in our life. They remind us that you are with us and you are present in this world that you love. Take these gifts and use them in your work and mission in this world, and instill in us generous and open hearts so that the promise that you are with us is felt by all people in all places. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Hello. We now transition from a time of worship to a time of prayer. We will offer prayers of people, of things, of places. And after each one, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and you'll answer, hear our prayer. What do we have to offer God today? Jan.
I would like for us to pray for the Venezuelan family, the Colazas, who came to our church a couple of weeks ago, and we have been working with them to get them furniture for their home, food for their pantry, jobs, cars, just all kinds of things that they need. They've now been here about 3 weeks, and I would just like for us to pray for them. I took them to church this morning, that's why I was late, at Guadalupe Center down in the West Islands. They're an amazing family. They love the Lord, and they are so invested in doing what most immigrants want to do, make it life better for their children. So we have one of the boys will be enrolled in high school this Thursday, and we're just looking for opportunities for them to be more financially.
Prayers for the Colazza family, who spent a few minutes with us here recently, and who many of the people in this congregation are helping. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. What other prayers do we have? Yes.
I ask for continued prayers for my sister-in-law, Susan Allen. She's having several health issues.
Prayers for Susan Allen and health issues for her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Other prayers we have. Liz asks prayers for all who are traveling, going back to school, back to home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Other prayers. Yes. Prayers for many in this congregation, including our staff, who've made this a wonderful season of Thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Other prayers we have. They were gathered in a certain place, and the disciples said to Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples. And he said to them, if you pray, pray in this manner. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Amen.
Friends, as we prepare for this joyful feast, know this, it is truly a joyful feast of the Lord. And it is said that people will come from north and from south, from east and from west, to sit at table in the kingdom of God. And according to Luke, after Jesus had died and been resurrected, he was at a table with his disciples, but they did not recognize him. That is, until he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. And then their eyes were opened and they saw that Christ was with them. Friends, this is the Lord's table. It's not mine and it's not yours. But it is a place where we are invited to sit with God, to feel Christ's presence with us, and to pull up a chair for anyone else who might stop by. This is God's table, and all who trust in him are welcome here. So let us pray together. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts, lift them up to the Lord. Let us give our thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O God, creator of the universe. You created light and darkness. You brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and called us to love and to serve you. When we were unfaithful, turning from your ways, you did not abandon us, but your love remains constant. You delivered us from captivity, made a covenant with our ancestors, and sent prophets to call us back to your way. And then, out of your unending love, you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, to be with us. Born in humility, he came to rule with justice and peace. Helpless as an infant, he showed the power of your love, what it means to love and be loved. Poor in possessions, he brought the wealth of your grace, and rejected by many, he welcomed all who sought him. In his living and dying and rising, he loved us, and had his heart and body broken for us, and delivered us from the forces of sin and death. Remembering the love of Christ, we take this bread and this cup, and we joyfully celebrate Jesus' presence with us now. We wait for the kingdom of God. Oh God, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, so that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and the blood of Christ. Through your Spirit's love, make us one with Christ. Make us one with all your children, united in ministry, united in service, united in care for our neighbors as we care for ourselves, so that the love we feel at this table extends far beyond our reach. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Friends, when Jesus was at table with his disciples, he took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup and he poured it out, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins, so that every time you drink of this cup and you eat of this bread, you do so in memory of me." Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite the ushers forward now. You are invited to this table now. Let us pray. Holy God, just as Jesus once relied on Mary for nourishment, we rely on you for sustenance in our lives. We thank you for this gift of a meal of bread and wine. May these gifts nourish us in ways food cannot. And through it, may we become your body in this world and live as instruments of your great love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Friends, hear the good news that was proclaimed to us on Christmas Eve. It is proclaimed to us every Sunday. It was true today. It will be true in 2024 as well, that God is with us through Christ and that we are called to be with one another through all of it. And so may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you today, tomorrow, and all the days to come. Amen. Good morning.
It's so good to see you.